From Screen Junkie Studios in the heart of Los Angeles, this is Screen Junkies Movie Fights. Now your host, Andy Signor.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another fantastic episode of Movie Fights. I already know in advance because these three people are pumped. They're ready. They're smart. They're challenged. They're gonna bring it. You guys are bringing it today, right?
Bring it.
They're bringing it. Today's fights are going to be awesome. We're going to pitch Austin Powers 4. We're going to be pitching who's the best character in the new Star Trek universe, as well as we got a lot of fun stuff. Stay tuned. It's going to be fun. But I'm most excited about these three guests. First up, he's back. Return to the show, baseball player, actor, and anti-hero, Cody Decker.
Hi, how's it going? I'm here to reclaim my title that I rightfully won the first time, and you deprived me of it.
I know. You were close. You were close on your first game out. He almost took it, but he lost.
I still have not slept well.
And now's your chance for redemption.
Yes, finally.
The fans are there watching.
All it took was for me to get fired. That's great.
Sometimes you're available again, right? I was like stoked. I was like, yes. No, I'm really happy you're here. He was a good competitor. Next up, two newbies, but she's not a newbie. She's fought hard on TV fights very many times. You made it to the finals. You're going to the TV Fight Belt Championship.
That's right. I am the round one championship winner. So technically, I am a champion right now.
You might be the TV Fights champion. We'll see you soon. But I'm so excited to have her back. Her first time Movie Fights, Sasha Pearl Raver. Welcome.
Thank you. This is so nerve-wracking. I don't know why. Like, Dan and I do a show on Mondays. It's live. And I'm like, anything could happen. Doesn't scare me. This is terrifying.
It is. The lights are so, can I just say, be nice people to our guests. Come on, they're here, they're ready. They may not, you might not agree with them, but we're here to have fun.
Sure.
I'm so grateful you guys, let's do this. Next up, you were on Screen Junkies this morning doing Talking Apocalypse. You're our Marvel expert, Marvel news, and you do Marvel movie news. Koi Jandrew, welcome.
How you doing? And I won TV Fights and movie games. So I'm going for the hat trick. I'm no slouch.
Shame on me for not knowing that. I'm so excited to have him back on the fan cam. I'm sorry, next to fan cam on the fan fact checking couch. Something was wrong with my notes and it's throwing me. Dan Merle,
hi.
Welcome back.
I'm here.
You're here.
I'm here.
You're here.
And I just want everyone to know that just because Sasha's my co-host, that does not mean I will show any favoritism. I'm neutral on movie fights, as are you.
You're
Andy.
Switzerland?
I'm Switzerland.
I like that.
You look fantastic, by the way.
Thank you, Cody.
Great shirt. Captain America.
He's
real
just
nice.
Sucking everybody up.
Yeah,
sucking up at everybody. Wow.
I'm going to wink at you later.
Next to him on the fan cam, I'm excited to have him here, Zach Roberts. Thank you, man. What, are you excited?
Yeah, it's going to be awesome.
You've watched the show. You're a fan of the show, I hear.
I am.
You're related to someone important to us, our very own Parker. And so we heard you're a fan. You're here. You going to help me judge?
Yes.
I might need a call to you at some point to help me, especially in the end. So pay attention to the arguments. And all of you at home, please pay attention to the arguments. This isn't about what I want, even though a lot of people think it is. It's not. I'm listening to your facts, and I'm listening to your creativity, your passion, your points. It's not just about your movie being the best. It's about taking the other two movies down. Everyone understand? Any questions before we begin?
Let's go!
Let's do it!
It's awesome.
Now let's do this!
Yeah. This is where we fight!
Fight! Round one. Now, the second Star Trek trailer came out, Star Trek Beyond, and most people thought it was definitely a better turn of events from the first one, which looked like a Fast and the Furious movie and not a Star Trek movie. This one definitely showed us a lot more to think about. But we wanted to talk about just that franchise in general and those characters. They're back. There's a bunch of wonderful actors playing those characters. We wanted to ask you, in this new and third movie in the rebooted universe, who is the best character so far in this new Star Trek world? You can pick anybody, any character from any of the current Star Trek movies, and we'll start with you, Cody. Who do you pick? Who's your favorite Star Trek character?
I decided to go with a completely unpopular opinion, and I'm actually choosing Khan. And here's my reasons for choosing Khan. One, every character that is actually in this new rebooted franchise is not bringing anything remotely new to the table. Khan brings several new things to the table. Things, one, obviously, whitewashing, and two, a British accent, which clearly makes him far, far scarier than Ricardo Montalban. So that alone, just his deep voice, he was by far the best actor on screen. Every scene he was in, he just stole the actual scene. Where I always looked at all the other characters as just cheap reboots of the exact same character, not bringing anything else. Kurt, just another thrill seeker. Scotty, well, really breaking it down by being Scottish. Brilliant. Just broke new ground and just, I've never seen such brilliance done. So I just thought Khan, even though a lot of the movie wasn't as well received, I actually personally loved the movie. I really enjoyed it. And I just thought his character I mean, everything about it. Everyone knew he was Khan, even though they did that whole hiding who he is. I mean, great, we know you're Khan. But I just thought he brought a lot of depth to the character. And, you know, he, despite all the terrible things he was doing, you were still kind of rooting for Khan throughout the entire movie. I actually kind of wanted Khan to win at the end, which I think also says enough about the characters in the movie that I don't care about. So, and as for the new movie, I'm not all that excited about it. I mean, it looks like the Enterprise is going to be explode again.
It's never happened before.
I mean, it did.
Breaks new ground.
All right, great. It definitely took the unexpected choice. I love that. Sasha, where are you standing?
I'm going to go with Scotty. And you can say, oh, it's a retread. He's Scottish. But the thing is Simon Pegg is never a retread. Simon Pegg is always original. Simon Pegg gave us so much with that character because, yes, we did have a certain expectation. And I think he is fresh. He's interesting. On top of it, let's go into something even deeper. He co-wrote this script, which means that we are going to get all of that Simon Pegg. We're going to get action. We're also going to get comedy. We're going to get that wit that we have come to expect from him. So he's doing more than just doing another character. He's giving new life to this franchise in a much bigger way. Also, on top of it, when you look at the relationship that J.J. Abrams and Simon Pegg have had, going back to MI3, the way they've grown, the way they've blossomed together, all the way through, like, The Force Awakens into this new Star Trek movie, you can see that they cultivate each other's success and each other's creativity, and they help each other flourish. And I think that's why this new Star Trek movie is actually going to be really good, because Simon Pegg has a bigger role. So it's not just that he's Scotty, and he is fantastic at Scotty, but he's many other things. And without him, we would have no "beam me up, Scotty." We would have no "I'm giving her all she's got, Captain." And what would Star Trek be without those two things?
Coy, who are you picking?
I had to go with the traditional choice because I believe the traditional choice is right. I believe Captain Kirk is the most interesting character because they've done an amazing thing by the first Star Trek being a prequel, sequel, reboot. They made a new universe that also existed within the old universe, and I feel like this Captain Kirk gives us something the old one didn't have, and that's an origin of the character's personality. I feel like through Chris Pine, we're learning the reasons that Kirk is the way he was with the other generations of Star Trek, and the people that love the old character get to appreciate the character all new because of Chris Pine's arc. The whole movie looks like, the new one looks like it's about masculinity, about being out of your father's shadow, about becoming your own man, and it looks like we're having a 3-movie arc for him to become Captain Tiberius Kirk, and we're seeing it fully fleshed out for the first time, and I love that it's taken 3 movies and 6 hours for us to get to the point where we believe that he's in the captain's chair for a reason.
Well, you can say that there's a reason for him to be Kirk and that it's taking 3 movies to be an arc, but that doesn't mean he's doing a great job with it. And if you look at both of your characters, if you Google or Wikipedia, either Captain Kirk or Khan, Montalban comes up for Khan, Shatner comes up for Kirk, and the thing that I think makes Simon Pegg so interesting is that he's not parroting a performance. What Kirk is sort of a lesser version of Shatner. What Khan is, I was like, oh God, I should rewatch that movie because I should have an argument. And then I remembered, I didn't remember Benedict Cumberbatch's performance because it's not a memorable performance.
It's literally
it's not
the only
good.
Thing I remember that movie.
See, I had the thing where I felt like as soon as he showed up on the screen, they were doing the thing I'd seen 5 times before. He was a guy in a glass cage, or he was a guy behind bars. Like, the Joker had already done that for me. And then for Scotty, I love Simon Pegg, but I felt like you did, where as soon as I saw Simon Pegg, I was like, oh good, Simon Pegg's here. I didn't feel like Scotty was there. I felt like Simon Pegg was there.
And I
love that.
And I truly love Simon Pegg, but I keep looking at your, one of your arguments was that he wrote the script, but that never clearly helped his character, because to this point, his character has done nothing.
No, this one. He co-wrote this script, and he is going to do stuff. If you look at the trailer, we see Scotty sliding off a cliff, hanging on by his fingernails. So we're going to get comedy from him, and we're going to get action from
him.
So you can't complain about the other ones because he wasn't involved. He's involved in this
him
one.
Holding off a cliff is not much different than him holding on to the edge of a thing while like a vacuum is pulling out, which did in the last
awesome.
Movie.
I feel like he's incredible comedic relief. I feel like they both served their purpose, but their purpose was to give Kirk a better story, and I feel like he's the heart of the franchise, and he's doing a great job, in my opinion. Chris Pine became Kirk through these films, and I like him better than Shatner.
What do you guys
say
to that?
Then how come his career has tanked? Then how come nobody's like,
Jack Ryan?
We should
that
do
wasn't a good
is...
move. No one should be
no,
Jack Ryan.
No, but nobody, like, Chris Pine was supposed to be one of the next great leading men.
He was phenomenal in Princess Diaries, too.
He was outstanding.
He stole the movie.
He's great
That's
in independent
true.
Films.
You're
when
welcome.
He has smaller roles, like Smoke and Aces, he's great. When he does these big movies to make his paycheck and then goes off and does smaller films, he's fantastic.
So you're saying he's not that good in big movies like
I'm
Star
saying
Trek.
These allow him to do better in small movies. I'm saying Stretch was incredible, and that couldn't exist without Star Trek. I'm saying Captain Kirk is great when he's in anything, and that this movie shows what Kirk can be.
But the thing is both of these characters are eclipsed by their previous iterations. Like, they were just... When you... Okay, who... You can't answer this, Andy. Who played Scotty originally?
Either one
of you guys.
I mean, that's not fair because everyone in this room completely knows everything about Simon Pegg. That's just pandering to all our nerddom.
Okay, then who played Khan?
Ricardo Montalban, but that's not because he was Khan. I remember Ricardo Montalban because of De Plane.
When I think of William Shatner, I think of Priceline commercials. When I think of Chris Pine, I think of Kirk.
Don't. Are you kidding me?
When I think of Chris Pine, I think of The Finest Hours.
I do. I think of his Pretty Eyes too. But I think of Captain Kirk, and I think of Shatner as an advertisement. He's a commercial guy now. Simon Pegg, I think of as Simon Pegg. I don't think of the characters he plays.
But is that because he gets so immersive in them that you feel like you get to know them really, really well, and then you have such like an excitement because you have loyalty to him as an actor and therefore him as a character?
I feel like I have loyalty to him as Simon Pegg, and therefore I'll see his movies and watch Simon Pegg as Simon Pegg.
I feel like Kirk can't grow unless he has a good villain, and he had a great villain in the second Star Trek movie. He did not have a great villain in the first movie, which was played by Eric Bana, which I can't believe I just remembered because that is about as unmemorable as possible.
But I feel like they blend together. I feel like the first two movies, when I look at them, I remember one being better than the other, and then I remember just going through it. But I do remember enjoying little moments of Kirk, like sitting in the chair, eating the apple. I remember action set pieces. I remember his growth as a character in both films, and I feel like this third one is a beautiful end to an arc.
But if you look at him, and if you are remembering Captain Kirk and thinking about him eating an apple, I feel like you do not have a great character. Like, when I think of Scotty, I think about his introduction. I think about that moment in the vacuum. I think about that moment in the trailer for the new film where we see him almost going off a cliff and then saving himself by a single finger. To me is more interesting. And to take a very small character and make somebody super memorable, that's more important.
The only thing I remember about Scotty is him rehashing old lines said from the original series.
That's iconic lines that if you didn't have in the franchise, you would be pissed. And he makes them his own.
But I feel like it's more important to have smaller scenes be memorable than have big action set pieces. If I can remember a guy sitting and eating an apple and have that be a great image of how good the character is, that to me
is a what was happening in that scene? Because I remember that scene too.
That was the scene where he had just defeated the unbeatable computer program.
Fine.
And he was
smug
enjoying the whole situation.
What's the name of that unbeatable
the Kobayashi Maru.
You're not supposed to answer me.
I want everyone to lose but me. I will answer everything possible.
The fact that he beat it.
Except you didn't know James Doohan. Yeah, okay.
There we go. Thank you.
So defeating that moment, having that moment, and the smugness of an apple is a beautiful cinematic tradition, and that to me is Kirk, and that's why he's the most important character.
You would have no running around, no beaming up. You need Scotty, and Simon Pegg is the perfect.
There is not a single show without.
There are so many other people who could have played Scotty. There are so many other people who could have played Kirk.
I agree, and also, I mean, Kirk is nothing without his supporting cast. Take away Scotty, take away Khan, take away Spock. Then what the hell is Kirk?
I wouldn't watch a Scotty show. I wouldn't watch a show.
You wouldn't
just
watch a show with just Simon Pegg as Scotty. That's a lie.
And I sure as hell would not watch a show just for Kirk. I really wouldn't. I just wouldn't.
Okay, if Khan is so great, then how come he's not in this next movie?
Because he's frozen in a time capsule. Really? Watch the movie.
Because you can't get unfrozen from a time capsule.
But who's going to unfreeze him?
So great, and he was so anybody. There could be any number of things that could happen that could be just plot conceits that could bring him back. But he wasn't that memorable. He wasn't that likable. He wasn't that beloved by fans. And when people talk about Khan in 10 years, nobody's going to be like, remember that great Benedict Cumberbatch performance? People are going to be like, remember that time that Ricardo Montalban played Khan and I loved it?
I talk Did about Benedict Cumberbatch's performance on a nightly basis.
I like the idea of looking back in 10 years because I think people will remember how good Chris Pine was as Kirk. I think they'll remember that Simon Pegg was in the movie, and I think they'll be a little embarrassed that Benedict Cumberbatch decided to be Khan.
Final thoughts, Sasha.
When you have a character that is small and yet is so memorable and doesn't just parrot another person's performance and gives you self-aware comedy but also gives you great action set pieces, that is a character that you need in a franchise to make it better.
When you have an iconic villain such as Khan that literally comes back and brings completely a whole new set of everything to the table, it was no way rehashed, you know, of what has already been done. It was something new and completely fresh.
Dan, tricky over there. What do you think of that? I'm sure you wanted to get in that fight. Huh?
Oh boy, did I want to get into that fight. Let me tell you. James Doohan, as many people on Twitter have also said, is the actor who plays Scotty. Sasha, I've got to ding you a little bit because you are right. When you Google Kirk and you Google Khan, Ricardo Montalban and William Shatner come up. When you Google Scotty, James Doohan also comes up. So, you know, that's...
None of them said
I'm
that.
I'm here to keep it honest. That's my job here. The Enterprise has been destroyed on screen twice in Star Trek III, The Search for Spock, and in Star Trek Generations. Beam me up, Scotty. It's like Play It Again, Sam. It's not a direct quotation. The words, beam me up, Scotty, have never been said or uttered in any film or television series. It's one of those misquoted, like in Casablanca, that's just in the lexicon. That's what James Doohan called his autobiography. And Chris Pine, yes, he has not lost launched a vehicle on his own. He is, however, in the upcoming Wonder Woman playing Steve Trevor, so he might have a second franchise under his belt at some point. They also put out a poll, but I will hold off on that until the end.
Based on the arguments, it came down to the final statements, and I just thought Coy slayed you both, because he really pointed out that it's really Simon Pegg we love, and we are too many people are embarrassed by your guy. So I thought Coy really brought it the heat there at the very end. Coy gets the point.
Good job, dude.
Dan, what did the voters say?
Well, it may be a little Simon Pegg love, like you said. 44% went with Scotty, 34% with Kirk, 22% backing Khan. In the
totally
fan
fair
poll on screen on Twitter.com.
Hard to not love Simon Pegg, really, but that's why you love the character and the actor. I don't know. That was a good point. Good job, Coy, but good job, all three of you. Let's go to round two. I bet you we're all excited for Alice Through the Looking Glass this weekend. The movie is not directed by Tim Burton. I think Philip, probably a lot of people are being tricked to think it is, because it's like from Tim Burton and it's, mm-hmm. he's not directing it. But Peyton Frank, Peyton10 on Twitter, asked us this question. He wants to know what Tim Burton movie most deserves a sequel. Now, I want to add a sequel that Tim Burton would direct. So I want to know what Tim Burton movie he's done deserves a sequel that he would then actually direct. It can be any movie from his history. And this time, Sasha, you're first.
The answer was in that tweet. It's Beetlejuice 2. Beetlejuice has been something they've been talking about for a really long time. They already have Michael Keaton signed on. Winona Ryder has already said she wants to come back and play Lydia. It's 27 years after the original. So this is something that already has forward momentum. This is something fans have been begging for. We all know that Tim Burton has had some stumbles recently. He needs to get back to the version of himself that made this movie. Somebody who deals with like little, you know, more animatronic stuff. Somebody who can make you a shrunken head man. Somebody who can dig back into characters that are beloved and not rely on CGI, not rely on a story that is already existing IP, but something that he really believes in and is personal to him, the same way like an Edward Scissorhands was personal to him. Michael Keaton is perfect at this point. We've got an Oscar winner. We've got the guy who's going to be in Spider-Man. This is such a perfect moment to throw him back into that franchise. Winona Ryder, I think, would be fascinating to watch. We need to see. She's one of the most talented and undervalued actresses we have.
Spock's mom in Star Trek.
Well, and she lasted for what? Two scenes and then she died. Let's get Winona Ryder back on screen. And my hope is that in this movie, Lydia is dead and she has to team back up with Beetlejuice and figure out how to be a dead person. And is that not a movie that every single person sitting on this panel wants to see? Coy is laughing because he's like, I totally want to see that. I think Beetlejuice is the answer.
Coy, what do you want to see?
I want to see Batman fixed. I believe that we live in a time of superheroes. It is the biggest resurgence of any genre, and that's the superhero film. And he, in a way, started it. I feel like his Batman allowed the movies that exist today to exist. There was a second wave after Spider-Man and X-Men, but Batman in 1989 really made the superhero film socially acceptable, and I don't think that he's given enough credit. And I feel like if he had a film now that brought Batman back away from Zack Snyder, away from this world that we're shaping, we could see and give credit to the trilogy that was never finalized, Batman Returns. I feel like having a Batman Beyond type film where Bruce Wayne is older, or a Frank Miller type film where Bruce Wayne is older, either of those iterations as directed by Tim Burton could be the Batman we need and the Batman we deserve after the mistakes that were made with the Man of Steel universe.
Cody, which Tim Burton movie do you want to see back?
I actually want him, I kind of went in a different direction on this, I want him to come back and do a sequel for A Nightmare Before Christmas, just for the sole purpose of him fooling everyone into thinking that he directed A Nightmare Before Christmas. Because it's titled Tim Burton's A Nightmare Before Christmas, directed by Henry Selick, the acclaimed director of Monkey Bone. So what I want is I'd like to see him come in, do a sequel, do something. It could even just be an absolute continuation of what had just transpired. A couple years later, maybe another holiday, something. Just something directed by him so he can make up to America for this past 15 years of lies.
Wait, if it's a continuation, I don't get it, because Oogie Boogie dies at the end, and gets the final snake stomped by Santa Claus. And what other holiday? Thanksgiving doesn't have a major like mascot. You've got the Easter Bunny, but
I love the Easter Bunny.
So basically, I'd love to see him take over Easter. So you don't like Jews because you want a Christmas movie.
I am Jewish, so clearly I don't like Jews.
Well, that's terrible, man.
Self-loathing. That's what we do.
I'm not self-loathing. Why can't it be a Passover movie?
It can be a Passover
movie.
But
let's go back to this. There is no
Mensch on the bench. He's there. He's taking on the Mensch on the bench role.
Everything was finalized in the end of the last movie. Like everything ended perfectly and happily. So
everything ended perfectly and happily in Beetlejuice, and I would love to see that. But I would still pay to see a sequel of Beetlejuice.
My problem with either of these sequels would be that those are both such sacred films that I fear that Tim Burton coming back would not be a good thing because of Tim Burton's new perspective. And I feel like we did have beautiful endings to both films. And I feel like if Beetlejuice comes back, it'll feel way more Hot Topic-y. It'll feel more like it's a concept on the play on goth culture.
I mean, you can say
it allowed that world to exist. And if we retread on it, it'll just feel like it's him trying to be Tim Burton again.
Every Tim Burton movie is Hot Topic-y, including his Batman movies. Hot Topic exists because of Tim Burton.
I'm saying in a post-Hot Topic world, I'm afraid of him going back to it.
But you say like having him fix Batman. I mean, I feel like his Batman movies have just as many flaws. We already got his Batman sequels, Batman Returns, and I despise that movie.
Oh, see, I would love to see Catwoman continue.
I just don't want
I might be alone here, but I'd love to see that.
And not to mention, you know, Tim Burton, I mean, he produced Batman Forever, so he was still around. So we got his trilogy, and it was awful.
I think he produced it by name because he was supposed to do the third film, and they took it away from him. I think that they were like, oh, he's a producer. I don't think that was his fault.
Not to mention, he kept killing his villains. I mean, Batman, Joker's dead now.
He had the best gallery of all time. He was supposed to come back in the third one. Jack Nicholson was supposed to have it. It was a whole thing.
I know, but it didn't happen. And instead, we got a dead Jack Nicholson, and we got a dead Danny DeVito, and we got a 19 times dead Catwoman who somehow is still alive.
She had a lot of lives.
It was just, I mean, I think he said all he needed to say with his Batman movies.
We can put the bow on it with that film that we don't have. We have the bow with these two films. We have a beautiful full structure. We don't have that with the trilogy.
Have a bow on the end of Beetlejuice. Beetlejuice, they all dance and they're around the table, but you don't know what happens with the family. You don't really know where Beetlejuice goes with the sand snake. There's so many unanswered questions, and I have a question for you that's unanswered. How does Tim Burton handle action? Because we have come to expect massive action set pieces from our Batman movies. Mm-hmm. He doesn't handle action well.
Well, that's why I'd want to do a Batman Beyond or a Frank Miller's Batman, because they're more personal films about Bruce Wayne the man.
Nobody wants to see a 70-year-old Batman.
No, I completely agree. We haven't seen the Batman origin done enough yet, so I agree. We should do the Frank Miller.
It's the end of Batman. It's the end of his life. It's once he's already grizzled and dealt with everything. It's Michael Keaton post-awards love getting his due to play the character he loves. It's the movie.
Does he love it? Didn't he do a movie about how he didn't love it?
Hey, Birdman got him the way he is now. Like, all this credit he gets is because of Birdman. I would love to see that pathos and grit put into Batman.
But when you talk to Keaton, which I have many times, he says the character that he misses most and the one that he would like to resurrect is Beetlejuice.
Is the one that he's getting paid to promote right now because they're talking about Beetlejuice
too? No, but if you're talking about something where the actor is going to be a huge part of it, mm-hmm. and you need to get him on board, there's no way he wants to do Batman. He actually wants to come back. He wants to be Beetlejuice again. He loves that character. He loves the fact that he still gets recognition for that character. And as far as The Nightmare Before Christmas goes, you still can't tell me a holiday that would work because it can't be Valentine's Day.
Why not?
It can't be St. Patrick's Day.
Why not?
Because St. Patrick's Day is already ruined by drunk people. It doesn't matter. You don't need anybody to show up. And
Hot Topics has been ruined by Tim Burton. What does it matter? He can do some more ruining of St. Patrick's Day. And quite frankly,
so
a lot of goth kids will get into drinking.
I want to know what the movie is because I don't see what the movie would be.
I mean, what does it matter?
I don't think you see what the movie would be.
What does it matter?
No, you're telling me. So basically,
he can take on any holiday. I mean, it's simply...
You're not... Tell me the holiday. Tell
okay,
me what
Valentine's
holiday,
Day.
Let's, and what happens?
I don't know. Let's say Jack Skellington gets his non-existent heart broken and immediately goes ahead and takes over Valentine's Day and needs to... build
so now
everyone's
Jack
hearts.
So now he's,
that wasn't bad.
So now he's the villain. You're taking Jack Skellington and making him the villain.
No, I said he's going to try and build his heart back up with the use of Valentine's
By
Day.
By ripping out other people's hearts so he can... No, that doesn't make sense.
I didn't say that. You're putting words in my mouth. You just rewrote my script and I'm not appreciating it.
Hollywood.
Welcome to Hollywood. Yeah. See, but Lydia Deetz, like a resurrection of Lydia Deetz is somebody that I think we would all like to see. To see him as Beetlejuice again makes total sense. And for it to be 27 years later is okay within that timeline because everybody's dead. For it to be a 27-year, or well, how many years later would it be for Batman?
89 is what,
my question is, does Beetlejuice still have a small head? Because how are we going to fix that problem?
No.
Now, my thing is the third Batman film
could... He was eaten by a sand snake. There's bigger problems that we have to figure out.
At the end of the movie, he had a small head. His head was shrunken. That was the ending of the movie. How do we fix this?
It was shrunken only for a minute, but there was the shrunken head guy who actually sits in the thing, but he was also eaten by a sand snake. There's all sorts of things. You have to say his name three times for him to come back.
But it ended with his head really tiny. How do we fix the problem?
How do we fix the problem of the guy that we say, Beetlejuice, Beetlejuice, Beetlejuice?
But his head stays the same size?
Yes, because he gets fixed. He was also a tiny little man living in like a
But his whole body was proportionate.
But he was also eaten by a snake, so you're still not focusing on the fact that everything will be fixed.
The screenwriters will figure that out.
No, they won't.
I was going to say that we need Batman fixed more than we need Beetlejuice or Nightmare on Night Before Christmas fixed, because those are already great. They're already done. They're already we cherish them as parts of our childhood. Batman is in a bad way right now, and that's why I think the third film's more important.
And that's why you need to trust it with the guy who has taken Alice in Wonderland and absolutely made it
trash. He's not directing
it.
He didn't do it. He's not come back for this next one.
But the first one.
That was Johnny Depp. I feel like Johnny Depp was just like, damn.
You can't blame the directing on Johnny Depp.
They've done seven movies together. You think that Johnny Depp doesn't control
Hey, here's another one. That's another reason to do it. Johnny Depp doesn't tell you how, like, involved in Beetlejuice.
He wouldn't be involved in Batman either.
You don't know that.
No, I don't trust that at all.
You know what we're going to say, Cody, about Batman? You were about to say something about Batman.
Oh, no, I totally agree with them. They shouldn't try and fix Nightmare on Elm Street.
They shouldn't. They tried that too. They really did. They tried. They hustled.
Yeah.
Freddy, he's good. Just let him settle.
Okay.
That's all I said. That was
I just feel lost now. The tangent again.
Final thoughts. Going,
We have been lied to as a public. It needs to be rectified. Because everyone sits around talking about the genius of Tim Burton and his direction of Nightmare Before Christmas, and it didn't happen. It's lies. We've been fed that for years. I feel as though this needs to be fixed, and that is my argument.
Let's make the movie that everybody involved actually wants to make. Keaton wants to make it. Ryder wants to make it. Burton needs to make it so we can remember that he's actually a talented genius. That is the film that deserves to be seen.
I feel like he shouldn't get credit for a beautiful film he didn't have anything to do with, and if he did the sequel, he would get that undue credit. I feel like I love the feeling that thinking of that film in my childhood gives me, and I know that I want Batman fixed, so I feel it's the only movie that deserves to exist from Tim Burton.
Dan!
Yes?
How you doing over there?
I'm good. Just a couple of clarifications in the realm of movies that people think Tim Burton directed but did not. Alice Through the Looking Glass is being directed by James Bobin. You might know him as the director of the new Muppets movies. Mm-hmm. I got to, in defense of Henry Selick, because Cody threw Monkey Bone in his face. He was also Oscar nominated for Coraline, which was best animated feature nomination. Yep. So he's got, it's up and down. But yes, Tim Burton also did not direct The Night Before Christmas. And on Twitter, people seem to be backing Mars Attacks as the Tim Burton movie that they would like to see a sequel to.
Why?
Deep or Deep None. Cuts. None or is none. Also a popular answer.
I wanted to put that Twitter. In.
I almost did.
And we have a poll site as well.
Okay, based on the arguments, you got hung up because I feel like you were like, wait, he didn't direct it, you didn't give me enough, and so Cody was out, sorry. I just wanted something aside from what you had already said, and then in the final you didn't give me more, and I thought they'd give me a little bit more clearer stuff. So it came down to Sasha and Coy. When you were fighting each other, there was one thing that sort of stood out, and I didn't hear enough complaints back, but can Tim Burton really do the action we want to do? You said he wants to see serious. That, coupled with the fact that everyone wants to do Beetlejuice a lot, helped, so Sasha gets the point.
I agree. I want to see Beetlejuice too. Dan,
what did they say online?
Congratulations, Andy. You and the internet are in agreement.
Oh, yay! So rare!
46% backed Beetlejuice, 28% backed Nightmare Before Christmas, 26% voted for Batman.
So rare that we agree. I'm so happy when it happens. All right, and next up. This one's a fun one. It could be a fun one. We'll see. It's up to you guys to make this fun. But Austin Powers 4 is back in the news. They're saying they might finally bring it back. Jay Roach made a quote saying that him and Mike Myers are still trying to figure out how to do it right, which bared the question, could we hear a good Austin Powers 4 pitch? You three are going to try. So this came in from Russell Michaels online on Twitter. It's a sort of a we sometimes spin these questions a little bit. I'm not reading what he said, but yes. What if you could pitch us the ultimate fourth Austin Powers movie? What would it be? Include a title, a log line, like a little bit about the movie. Who's the villain? Who's the love interest? And of course, it's gonna have a celebrity cameo or two. Coy, you're up first. What's your Austin Powers movie called?
Austin Powers in Groovy Never Dies. Ooh. So the idea is that Austin Powers represents a commentary on the genre of spy film, and currently spy films always seem to involve agency monitoring or defunding, or, you know, there's a very familiar trope, even Civil War did it, where we're like, this is an outdated thing, we need to be more careful. So I like the idea of Austin Powers being defunded, and he is no longer a spy. He cannot do his spy things. But he encounters a swing club that they discover is selling guns and you know, sex slavery, doing all these things, and only his groove gets him into the club. Only Austin Powers is groovy enough to be allowed into the swingers club because it's a 70s theme swingers club, or 60s, depending on how which generation they want to go with. Now, the leader of this club will be played, of course, by Daniel Craig, because that'd be a great commentary in the current Bond, and he is named Martin Shagwell. And at the end of the film, we find out that Martin Shagwell is in fact the father of the first film's Heather Graham through time travel trickery. And also in this club is Seth Green's Scott Evil, who Dr. Evil believes has been kidnapped, but we find out is actually working against his dad to start his own evil empire, because he wants to be his own Mr. Evil, his own man. So Seth Green is leading this thing along with Daniel Craig, and we have Dr. Evil having to team up with Austin Powers, which would be fun because they're both played obviously by Mike Myers, and the two agents that are supposed to replace Austin, the new square guys, to be played by Zac Efron and Dave Franco. Now, I thought that the love interest should be a pop star, since we had Queen Bey handle the duties last. I thought T-Swift as Misty Hart would be fun. So Misty Hart, as played by Taylor Swift, the love interest, and then all the other agents, little cameos of agents that were being defunded, could be played by whoever was still alive from the Bond franchise. So we could have Roger Moore, we could have Sean Connery, whoever wanted to show up, because that'd be a fun little commentary for our spy fans. And then I thought the head person in charge of the agency could be Judi Dench, because it'd be fun with Bond stuff. So, Austin Powers and Groovy Never Dies.
All right, sign me up. Cody, what's your pitch?
My film is titled Austin Powers and Hymens Are Forever.
Jesus. Graphic.
This is the plot. Mr. Bigglesworth is kidnapped by the dastardly Jowls. Jowls, an incredibly large man with only adult braces, played by the Great Khali. WWE superstar, the Great Khali. He was also in Get Smart as the gigantic man villain.
Great. Okay.
Okay. Dr. Evil enlists the help of Austin Powers to get him back. At their aid is the beautiful Sookie Cox, who is perfectly portrayed by Jennifer Lawrence, because they always pick someone who's kind of sometimes the it person, and Jennifer Lawrence kind of fits that bill at the moment. Who is the object of both Austin and Dr. Evil's affections, which leads to this fun and distracting love triangle between the three. There is always a, in Austin Powers movies, there's always a weird musical break with someone. So I was thinking someone that fits the mold of Burt Bacharach and Elvis Costello. I thought Billy Joel should be their musical break in the middle of the film, just unnecessarily planted like the other two times. And I think with him should have John Mayer. And hear me out, and this is why you should have John Mayer. At the end of the song, John Mayer should try and hit on Sookie Cox, and leads to a great scene where Dr. Evil kills him. And that way the audience all get their dream of watching John Mayer die. Celebrity cameos, because there's one thing about the Austin Powers movies that they're incredible. They're not, they don't, their shelf life isn't great. They don't date well. There's always jokes for at the time. Like, for instance, when they did the I did it again joke when he blew up Britney Spears. I think that there's no one more in the modern time that will, jokes I don't think will last the test of time. The celebrity cameo should be Donald Trump. Also, he would do it. He would be in it because he's a fame whore, and he would absolutely be in Austin Powers 4.
Has he not already done one of those three movies? Surprisingly.
Other cameos, Olivia Munn, because she's apparently in everything, and no one has been able to successfully tell me why she's famous. So that's my pitch for Austin Powers.
The plot again was...
was Mr. Bigglesworth gets kidnapped, and Dr. Evil enlists the help of Austin
Jowls?
Powers.
Oh, no, of Austin Powers.
He's kidnapped by Jowls.
So they're working together.
They're working together. So it's basically a buddy cop movie with Dr. Evil and Austin Powers.
Okay, got it. Sasha, good luck following these two, right?
All right. My film is called Austin Powers, Ladies and Gentleman. In this, it's set in the 80s, Scott Evil, Seth Green, has gotten what he said he wanted. He is going to get back, not just at Austin, but at the world. In a Trumpian moment, he is elected POTUS. He is now President of the United States. At his inauguration, he says, "I am going to launch every nuclear warhead we have in America unless you pay me $1 trillion and every country in the world sends me their hottest woman." So now there is going to be the most uncomfortable Miss Universe pageant ever held, and the hottest chicks from every nation are going to come to compete to be the First Lady and the First Lady's harem so that Scott Evil can have his bizzitches. And what happens is Austin Powers and Foxy Cleopatra, because you are not making this movie without Beyonce, who is bringing more beautiful Beyonce now back. Okay. Than she was when she did the last film. They have to infiltrate the pageant to take out the fembots who are posing as Miss Paraguay and Miss Korea so that they can go in. Obviously, Beyonce is going to be Paraguay and Austin's going to be Miss Korea, so they can be in the pageant so they can try to take out Scott Eastwood. Scott Eastwood. Whoa, different. Scott Evil.
Scott Evil. Boy,
Scott Eastwood.
I really got on board with this movie all of a sudden.
Scott Evil. So, we have celebrity cameos by Idris Elba, who is an incompetent spy who gets taken out instead of actually doing the job that Austin Powers now has to fill in. You have George Clooney, who is a celebrity judge who is fed to the laser sharks. And then you have Kate Upton, Jennifer Aniston, Lupita Nyong'o, Sandra Bullock, and Gwyneth Paltrow, who all show up because they've been told by People Magazine that they are the most beautiful woman in America, only to find out Megan Fox is already playing that part because Michael Bay is directing the entire Miss Universe pageant. And it's all about them taking down Scott. But the thing is Austin falls for Miss Australia, Miranda Kerr, and almost botches the entire plan.
Okay.
Right. The end.
Got it.
One massive argument to your film.
Yes, sir.
Heather Graham was in Austin Powers 2.
Touche. But still, I want that cameo by the dad, the time travel. Because I think time travel through these films is really important and underutilized as far as sure. It's used for comedy, but I think with a fourth film happening so late in the game, using time travel is the only way to make it kind of work, because they're going to look, you know.
We're just going to Days of Futures Past this bitch.
We're just going to go right through.
Well, that's why
we're
mine in the 80s.
Why is your ticket better than the other two?
Well, I have two major points for yours. Yes. Number one.
And make sure we have a poll up here. I want to know what the audience is buying their tickets to. Yes,
number one.
I think they're trying to figure out how to make that
poll. I'm in there forever, ladies and gentlemen, and Groovy never dies.
Andy had to re-ask you your plot because it was so like rambling and not really that.
I do have
not
a bad
much,
memory.
But there's not that much at stake with the cat. But here's the bigger thing. I called the MPAA after I heard what your title was going to be. And I said, I spoke to a lovely woman named Judy.
This is serious?
This is completely serious. I called the MPAA. They're based in the Valley.
Yeah.
And I said, if there was a movie that had the title Hymen in it, would it change its rating? And they said, that's interesting. We've never had that as a question before.
You're not on a lot of government lists.
But I said, because these movies are, you know, they're supposed to be like, you can have Sookie Cox, but it's supposed to be a little bit tongue in cheek. And they said it absolutely, unless if it was done in a medical way, would change the rating. So already your title sort of nullifies the possibility of this being something that would be marketable, because there's no way that national television is going to run. Because I also asked a friend who works at Warner Brothers, and I said, what would happen if a primetime show tried to buy advertising where the movie was called Hymens Are Forever or whatever? And she was like, we couldn't air it until after 10 p.m. So your movie's not going to have an audience because no one's going to know about it because it can't be marketed.
Well, here's the issue. I know for a fact you're lying because I stood next to you the entire time and at no point were you on your phone, which would have been a breach of the rules of the game, so you are now no longer in the game.
I have to say,
well,
as far
she
as...
might have been, she's allowed to use her phone after, before the show.
I feel as if the title Groovy Never Dies is the one that would actually be a parody of both
she's
a Bond
NBA.
Film.
I believe you.
She thinks same the number as MPAA. Like,
did you put it in your contact? There it is.
I called her at 2:40.
Just in case you have to call back. All just right. In case. Yeah.
Confirmed.
So I feel like it's a series of scenes with your film. The overall arching plot is not something. It'd be a great opener. It'd be a great idea to begin. And then I feel like we already had Miss Congeniality, though. I feel like we already have a spy movie that's based around a, you
and
know.
Didn't, wait
well,
a second.
Well, that's an FBI movie, not a spy movie.
Right, but it's a similar
and
ilk.
We haven't had that in about 15 years.
Okay.
And we know that it is a trope that actually works really well. And there is something that will translate very easily because you have to think about marketing. These were movies that have to work internationally.
Right.
If you've got a ton of hot chicks and you've got Mike Myers in a dress, you now have an international
audience. So now we got Mrs. Doubtfire and... basically the Miss America pageant.
We also
fantastic.
Have the problem that it's 2016. We live in a world where there's a lot more political correctness that's necessary. I'm not sure
that's why I chose Paraguay and Korea.
But I'm not sure they'd allow Mike Myers to be like just being completely sexist towards women nowadays. I don't know how that movie could exist.
Oh, you don't think sexism exists in Hollywood?
I think it does, but I think they're not going to encourage it by giving Mike Myers that much free reign to only be sexist. Have every joke about sexism. That'd be a very
they're not. It's all well. I mean, every one of these titles, you've got your whole thing set at a sex club, and you're telling me that a beauty pageant is too sexist?
I'm saying that sexism is the evil instead of the good.
No, sexism isn't evil. Scott Evil is the evil.
No, in my film, sexism is the evil.
I honestly don't understand what the argument is that you guys are having.
They were spinning, yeah. I get it now.
I'm saying that 2016, I'm not sure we'd make a film like Miss Congeniality. I'm not sure we'd have that kind of genre where Mike Myers would have free reign to make these kind of jokes. Mike Myers in a dress might have been more funny in the 90s than it would be today with the way we're trying to bring comedy is my only
point. I don't know. Jack and Jill was made.
That's not funny.
That shouldn't exist. Jack and Jill should not
but
exist.
But these are movies that are made, and that made a lot of money. Especially internationally. Yes, it did.
Adam Sandler as a pro in any pro and con list is a bad decision.
That's absolutely true.
I feel like Adam Sandler shouldn't be pointed out like, this is the thing we need.
Yeah. But the thing that I think would make my movie super fun is we do have the Trump phenomenon going on right now, so people are aware of this kind of stuff. We also have, I mean, the fun of being able to bring these characters back and have familiarity. Like, I think it's important to have Beyonce to come back again because Mike Myers, let's be honest, has been out of the game for a really long time, and we need to know more. Like, whether you bring Heather Graham back, whether you need something else that reminds you of why these movies were funny, but you also have to make it relevant, which is why I think you have to surround them with people like Idris Elba. You have to have a Megan Fox. You have to throw a Michael Bay cameo in there so it's like, oh, look, it's still relevant and we're still poking fun at the thing we're aware of.
All right, what about in each one of the Austin Powers movies, where's the villain that is poking fun at Bond movies? Where's the gold member? Where's the random task?
Mine is all Bond, previous Bonds.
No, you just have Bonds, but you don't have actual Bond villains that are being made fun of and portrayed in the movie. Random task was a takeoff.
Daniel Craig as Martin Shagwell, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but so who is he a takeoff on?
My thing is a meta commentary on the Bond films themselves. Because
that's what the Austin Powers movies already are.
Right,
so
it's layers.
Where is the character that is simply just the villain? That is just the takeoff on Odd Job, taking off on Mr. Kill, anyone.
That's the difference in mine, is a takeoff on 70s Bond as the villain. I want Daniel Craig as a Bond-esque character to play a Bond-esque villain. The whole commentary isn't on villains, it's on the actual lead.
No, I understand that, but are there any like, each one of these movies has a very significant, it's almost like the same exact thing happens in each one of the movies. I mean, are you just breaking completely away from what
I'm breaking
that
away from the meta joke on the villain to make it a meta joke on Bond. So, yeah.
Wait, if the same thing happens in every one of the movies, then because, like, I'm bringing back Scott Eastwood. Mm-hmm. Oh, Jesus, I really want Scott Eastwood. Yeah.
Scott
Is
Evil.
He here? Are you here?
I just, when I say Scott, I say Scott Eastwood's name so often in my fantasy life. Who are you bringing back? Like, where is the trope that we will, besides...
Scott, not Eastwood, Scott Evil. I was this close. I didn't say it, though. You did. I almost did, but I didn't. I caught myself. Scott Evil is in the movie. He is the person behind the kidnapping. He's getting back at his father by stealing his cat.
Sounds like a side character as opposed to like a real...
No, he's the big bad behind his henchman, which every evil character in every Bond movie and Austin Powers movies needs a henchman. His henchman is Jowls. A takeoff on Jaws from The Spy Who Loved Me and Moonraker.
But it also feels like a bad ripoff of Fat Bastard, and Fat Bastard is better than Jowls. Why wouldn't
Fat
you just
Bastard
bring back
is thin
Fat
now,
Bastard?
Because he's thin now. He got on the Subway
right,
diet.
And then he got
just
off
like
of
Jerry.
It because of child porn, and now he's fat again.
Wouldn't that just make him thinner?
All right, Koi, final thoughts.
I feel my film has the most familiar tropes to the Bond films, which is what the Austin Powers movies kind of base themselves on. I feel like it has all the characters we know and love. I feel like it brings back mythology from the past, which in a film set so many years after the last iteration really needs to do.
Sasha.
Mine brings back familiar tropes, not of the Bond movies, but of the Austin Powers movies, including characters, things we've come to love, but it also has social commentary that deals with our political environment right now, which is what the Austin films always have done and what you need for a good satire. Plus, I got hella hot chicks up in mine.
Cody.
Mine also brings back the trope of the Austin Powers movies, not to mention it has an unnecessary musical break, which all of them have for no reason. And this one desperately has one with a satisfying ending of the death of John Mayer.
Dan.
Yes. Other than confirming that the MPAA is indeed based in the Valley, I,
I drive by it a lot.
I cannot confirm or deny Sasha's MPAA source.
Can that be a, Sarah, can we just make that a show where we just call the MPAA?
Andy, no, Donald Trump has not been in any of the Austin Powers movies. His appearances do include Zoolander, Home Alone 2, Lost in New York, The Little Rascals, and apparently as an uncredited extra on the TV show Monk.
Was it just in the neighborhood?
I guess he was just a
maybe he was on TV.
I own this building. I want on show.
Man, it says like man and party. I don't know.
Oh, God.
And also, before you start sending us your casting for Sookie Cox, I would also like to note that I have tracked down news stories from May 2007, July 2008, August 2011, August 2012, May 2014, and July 2015 talking about Austin Powers 4. So I wouldn't start the fantasy casting just yet.
Wow.
Oh man, Zach, how was that round for you?
That was awesome.
Was there a movie? Was there a movie you would actually buy a ticket to up there?
Of course, yeah.
Which one?
Koi.
Thank you.
Koi's.
For sure.
Yeah, I mean, I gotta say that's where I'm going leading to. Just, I think he gave me the defunded plot actually was pretty fun. I thought some of your cameos were great, and then it came down to you second place, Sasha. But I'm giving Koi the point.
Wow.
But yours is just a little all over the place. John Mayer dying was a bonus point. I wrote that down. you had me with the hymen calling the MPAA, but then you brought up Jack and Jill. So it canceled them out.
Damn!
And then I had to go with just the pitch, and I thought Koi brought a little bit of a stronger pitch and some creative outside-the-box ideas of bringing Daniel Craig as a villain. Good title, and it wrapped around. So Koi got the point. Good job, guys, though. Cody, you're still in this. You just have to win.
I'm not remotely fucking in this.
I had Tom Hardy as your Idris Elba.
Who won that on Dan?
On Twitter, let's see. The winner at 50% is Groovy Never Dies.
Nice.
Hyman's a Forever, 33%.
They just like the title.
I think it's just they're looking at the title.
That's just the title.
I do, though, now that we're out of the heat of the round, Twitter is very curious, Sasha, if you actually did call the MPAA.
I swear to God, on my mother's life, I called the MPAA. I talked to a
let's
woman.
We'll talk more after the fight. Yeah, we'll call him again. We'll try and call him again. Maybe we can call him live. I don't know if we can be on air, but we'll do it. Round four. John Carpenter's back, saying he's going to return to the Halloween franchise as an executive producer. So Blinkin' Black asked us, what director should return to save a franchise? So if with John Carpenter coming back to do Halloween, if we could pick any director to come back and save one of their franchises or redo, or not redo, but you know, bring back their franchise, which one would we want? Cody, you're first.
I went back and forth on a lot of things here, but due to all the recent activity in the DC universe, whether you love it or you hate it, I think it's time to do whatever we can to bring back Christopher Nolan back to Batman / the DC Universe. Mainly because I'm not as on board with the new job runners in Geoff Johns, because he did have a heavy hand in that wonderful Green Lantern movie we all got to experience. When it comes to the DC movie universe, the only movies that everyone really, really... I mean, the expectation for Batman v Superman was exceedingly high. So was Man of Steel. But nothing was higher than it was for The Dark Knight. And it delivered on every possible angle. And I think it's time to bring back that grit, less outrageous CGI, you know, just a little more, bring it back to not bare bones, but more of a practical film, you know, and get away from the splashy CGI fest that was Batman v Superman. I honestly do like where the Batman is right now in the DC universe. So I kind of would like to see Christopher Nolan's addition to it, and how he would take care of Wonder Woman, how he would usher in Aquaman. Would he, you know, it just seems like it seems safer in his hands and less in Zack Snyder's, and you know, not, and it just, it's hands that we know and we trust, and he's been in that world before, and he's delivered on every single one of his performances. So that's my point.
Sasha, what's your pick?
I said Ivan Reitman for Ghostbusters. Hear me out. Okay, we already know that he came back as a producer on this one. But I'm talking about him coming back as a director. He directed the first two. He's an incredible, incredible director. People really undervalue Draft Day, which came out in 2014. I think that was a much better movie than people wanted to talk about. I think that, okay, I talked to somebody who's over at Sony, and they said, whether we like it or not, there's going to be another Ghostbusters
film. Name dropper.
Sorry. Listen, making points here. There's going to be another film. They're already working on scripts. They're already meeting with writers. So we need to have
Even if this bombs.
Even if this bombs. Now, if this completely bombs, including internationally, they might pull the plug on it, but they are meeting with writers right now. So we know this is moving forward. If it does, let's give it back to the guy who started it. Let's give it back to the guy who produced this most recent one, knows all the problems internally because he's been around, but wasn't necessarily in a situation where he could step in and say, don't do that, change this. You can't make this scene be this way. No, re-edit that trailer. Producers have a certain amount of, you know, input, but it's never going to be the director guiding the vision. I want to see him when we have the inevitable next sequel. I want to see him take it back over and get us back to the place of the first one, which is where everybody wanted this to be in the first place.
Coy.
Lethal Weapon is my favorite franchise of all time. I think they are a near perfect set of films. I think they only, I think it's one of the few franchises that actually references the prior films in a beautiful, believable way. Injuries are used later in films. It's a beautiful, serialized arc, and that is something the Marvel films are doing brilliantly now, is that they're connecting their films a la television. They're making it serialized. Lethal Weapon did that long ago. Lethal Weapon caused the action comedy to be arguably what it is today, and I think it is still the best buddy cop and buddy series of films. Lethal Weapon 4 did not finish that franchise well. Lethal Weapon 4 was good, it wasn't 1, 2, and 3. Lethal Weapon 4 happened so many years ago that a new film closing out the series could be something new, could be something different, could allow us to give it the closure that series deserves. Lethal Weapon 5 today would have them both be too old for this shit, and that could be amazing. I love the idea of Richard Donner coming back to Lethal Weapon. His last two films were 16 Blocks and Timeline. The man that directed Goonies and Superman should not have his last two films be 16 Blocks and Timeline. He needs to close out a franchise he made wonderful. Mel Gibson could get redemption whether you think he needs it or not or deserves it or not. Danny Glover doesn't get enough work, and Richard Donner should close out his Lethal Weapon series strong with a fifth movie, and I think they'd all do it if Dick Donner came back, and I want that.
The last movie Richard Donner directed was 10 years ago. He's 86 years old. Grandpa does not
Clint Eastwood's
need...
killing it, and he's...
Grandpa needs to put the camera down. I have a lot of issues with Clint Eastwood, but we're not talking about that. We're talking about Richard Donner.
But
and you're talking about, yes, it is a great serialized arc. It is, what you said, what inspired a lot of TV. It did. There's a horrible show that's about to
debut on
CBS. That's
why I don't want that to exist. I want
Right, but it
five
is,
to,
and it's
to
moving forward.
That.
And if you watch that trailer is hideous. And I don't think Richard Donner is in any place to step in and fix anything. The last Mel Gibson thing that he top-lined was in 2011, The Beaver, which made under $1 million in the U.S. And I'm sorry, I don't want Mel Gibson to have redemption, but we're not going to get into that here. And unless you're talking about Donald Glover taking over, there's no way that this cast would actually work. Richard Donner is too effing old. It's done.
I mean, I don't think you're in a place to talk about an old comment when you're talking about Ivan Reitman coming back. I mean, these are two men that are completely out of touch. I mean, his last two movies are Draft Day, which, by the way, was borderline unwatchable.
I liked it.
And not
Adam
to mention my
cameo in that, it would have been a whole picture.
And not to mention his other movie was My Super Ex Girlfriend, another top notch film. I mean, and as for Lethal Weapon 5, I would kill to see a Lethal Weapon 5, but I would rather see someone else take the helm, such as Joe Carnahan, director of Stretch. I think he would be a perfect fit. Also, I think the TV show's on Fox, not CBS.
It looks like it's canceled regardless.
Lethal Weapon's not going to exist well on TV. I think it deserves the last movie to exist. And I know that Mel Gibson and Danny Glover both said they'd only come back if Richard Donner came back. That's important to me.
Because they're waiting for him to die because he's so old. And as far as Christopher Nolan doesn't want anything to do with the Batman franchise. He doesn't want anything to do with DC anymore. He's out. He's over it. And really, he's never let us down. Interstellar, my friend.
I loved Interstellar.
That movie was garbage.
Loved it.
Dark Knight Rises was rough.
Dark Knight was incredible.
Batman Begins was incredible. Dark Knight Rises did not end that trilogy the way he had pointed it. And he also produced these last two films. He produced Man of Steel. And
did he produce Batman v Superman?
Yeah,
I doubt
yes.
he didn't produce
no,
it.
No, he did.
Him and his wife, man. Their names are on it.
Their names are on it. But just that goes back to your argument. How much did Tim Burton have to do with Batman Forever?
Okay,
his name was on it.
But he wasn't on these films. He wasn't attached more than three. He decided to go like, well, this is the thing I want to be involved with. That scares me.
No, I will literally, now I literally will name drop. So I sat down for an interview with Zack Snyder.
Oh, Jesus.
And let me tell you. Sorry about it, bro.
My buddy Chris.
Yeah.
She's using what she got in her arsenal.
Listen, I sat down with Zack Snyder and he gave me 15 minutes on how involved both, oh my God, help me, writer, give me.
Jonah Nolan?
No, give me on Blade. Blade writer.
Oh, David Goyer?
Thank you. David Goyer and homeboy, your boy, Nolan, were involved in the BVS process. They would sit there and they would have script meetings for 7 hours in a day. So you can't sit here and be like, well, he needs to really come back.
There were writers on that film.
He's over it. He's given it up. He just wants the paychecks.
You're absolutely right. No one in Hollywood has ever lied in an interview.
Well, that was a sit-down interview, right? So maybe they're a little more forthcoming. I just know that his name is attached to it, and the fact that his name was involved with that Batman worries me, because Ben Affleck did rewrites. Ben Affleck, I think, is going to make a great man Batman going forward.
I agree, too.
But I don't think that Nolan cares enough to give Ben Affleck's Batman his due, whereas Richard Donner, if we can get him back, loves that franchise, and Mel Gibson loves that franchise. Danny Glover loves that franchise.
Mel Gibson loves any franchise that'll have him back.
Yeah. I loved Get the Gringo, because I thought it was like a great Lethal Weapon 5. I want to actually have that exist. And I think there's a market for it. Action comedy needs to come back. Superhero movies will eventually pop the bubble. There
what
will
are you
be an
about?
End of superhero films.
Action comedies need to come back. Did you not see Deadpool? Did you not see 22 or 21 Jump Street?
Non-superhero films. I love superhero films. It's my entire
22
world.
Jump Street is not a superhero
and
film.
And now they're making it with Men in Black. That's not a good sign. They're going to merge those two franchises. We're at a point where we're at critical mass with action comedy. We need to make sure we use the right properties. And right now, I'm not sure we are. And I feel
Bad
like
Boys
Lethal
3.
Weapon is a great.
Bad Boys.
Michael
you have
Bay.
You have more action comedies than there are tons of them. Mm-hmm. There are plenty of options. Richard Donner is not the guy. If you hadn't done something in 10 years and you tried to do it again, do you think you would do it well, or do you think you'd be a little bit rusty, especially if you were 86 years old?
Well, in the same vein, Ivan Reitman hasn't directed a Ghostbusters movie in 30 years. He might be a little bit old. He might be a little out of touch, judging
you know
by
what?
My super ex-girlfriend and Draft Day.
Yeah, but you know what he has in his arsenal? His son, Jason Reitman, who's incredible, super talented, and is
really?
Very much...
Did you see Young Adult? That was a piece of shit.
I completely disagree.
I would see Jason Reitman's. I would see Jason Reitman's Ghostbusters before I'd see Ivan Reitman's Ghostbusters.
I think that you are discounting the guy who gave us Dave, who gave us Ghostbusters, who still has a lot
Goonies,
to offer.
Superman, Lethal Weapon 1-4. The guy in like made
16 blocks timeline.
That's why I want to fix it. That's why I want to just cleanse that palette.
I don't know if it's cleansable.
I didn't like Interstellar either. I just it hurt me. Like I felt like I was watching a film where it was a guy that wanted to love NASA and then found it. He was just like, I'm gonna go for a walk. Oh, NASA's here. That's good. They need me. Like that didn't even make sense. The first act at
it would be like if Scott Eastwood walked in right now.
And
I'm like,
oh, hey, you called? I'm Scott Eastwood.
I was stuck
I don't know what else he's doing. He might be here.
All right. Final thoughts. Let's start with you, Cody. Last thought here.
I mean,
I need something new from each of you.
Yeah, I would just like to see it get back to more practicality, a lot less digital effects. I think a much more seasoned director such as Christopher Nolan, who actually does a ton of visual effects, but has actually made them interesting and, you know, believable. It doesn't have to be a massive green screen extravaganza, and I would like to see it get back to that.
The audience wants what we got with the first and second Ghostbusters, especially the first. And if you want what you got originally, then go to the person who gave it to you originally, because you know that you can trust him. And I think that Ivan Reitman is the man to give the audience what they've been screaming for.
I feel like Ben Affleck is going to do a better job taking care of the character of Batman than a post-Dark Knight Rises Chris Nolan would. And I feel like I would care more about seeing Lethal Weapon 5 than Ghostbusters 3. I stand by Lethal Weapon being a more important franchise starter and new set of films than Ghostbusters.
Ooh, this one's tough. Dan, anything to add over there?
Well, there's so much hearsay involved in this round. It's hard to cut through it and figure out. So here's what I don't think anyone is quite as removed. Not anyone, but I think Nolan and Reitman aren't quite as removed from either franchise as I think it's been made out. Nolan, of course, was credited as an executive producer on Batman vs. Superman, so he had something to do, at least, with that movie. Ivan Reitman is credited as a producer on the new Ghostbusters, and even I found the story a couple months ago, he said that he was in an advisory position on this new movie, not necessarily in creative control, but as an advisor, he was available and gave his input on certain things. According to Richard Donner and Mel Gibson, Shane Black wrote a draft of Lethal Weapon 5, but Richard Donner said in 2012 that Mel Gibson turned it down and that the movie was essentially dead in the water.
All right. So, Zach, any thoughts over there?
I think Sasha really controlled the room on that one.
She did. She did have some control there. Good. All right.
Volume. It's called volume, not
she
control.
Defended Draft Day.
Don't hate it, man. Sometimes it works.
Draft Day is a good movie, man. Ugh. Next time it's on HBO. Listen, I'm sorry, professional baseball player who's like, that's not what a draft's like.
It's not what a draft's like.
Yeah, like you would know. He would know his stuff.
I know.
Yeah.
I know.
All right. I'm going through these notes because it is tough. You made a very good argument for the Lethal Weapon franchise. I think they are good films. It did go out in a sour note, so very good point. You, however, did make a good point. He's not who knows if he's any good anymore. And his last few movies have not been as very good. That said, and you made a good point of we need to fix Ghostbusters and try and do it. But then they both said that, is he really the man for the job? He hasn't done much stuff lately that warrants that he could really take it back. And then for you, Cody, with Batman, I mean, I think everybody would love Nolan to come back and do a good Batman movie, but they also made good points in that why he wouldn't, and it sort of doesn't make sense. So it's really tough for me because you all really actually hit each other really well. Taking out, man, I'm just trying to grasp at something here to make me clearer. I think I gotta go with, it doesn't matter if he doesn't want to do it. I think Cody gets the point. Nolan doing a Batman could be great. And I think both of you sort of canceled each other out in a way where then I didn't hear enough negative reasons why it's really bad for Nolan to do it. So I'm going with Cody. That's where it went. Dan, what was the vote?
The vote on Screen Junkies was, not surprisingly, 58% voted for Christopher Nolan to return to the DCU, 27% Ivan Reitman Ghostbusters, 15% Richard Donner and Lethal Weapon.
They were like, Richard Donner's
still
alive?
Who's Richard Donner? I was not born yet.
I was hung up on he wouldn't want to do it, but that's not what the question was. He could do it, and if he did, I think we'd all pay a ticket to see Nolan's next Batman. So round five.
If I get 10 people to watch Lethal Weapon tonight, I'm happy.
Yeah.
If I can spread that
Koi, love. You're automatically in the finals. Cody and Sasha, the winner of this round will take Koi on to the finals, unless Koi wins, and then we'll do a tiebreaker.
Sweet.
But this is a fun one. Thor Ragnarok is going to be an intergalactic buddy movie, so we're being told. So we thought it'd be fun for you guys to pick two characters from any movies that you'd want to see team up in a buddy movie. So you can take any movies, characters from any franchises, pick two of them, put them together, and tell me why that's going to be a fun movie to watch. Sasha, go ahead.
Okay. I would like to see, and this is a movie a lot of people haven't seen, I would like to see the nice guys, Ryan Reynolds, Holland March is his character's name, and John Wick, Keanu Reeves, John Wick, team up. In the film, they have to take over for Lance Reddick as the new concierge at the Continental Hotel in John Wick, and hilarity ensues. Now, why would this be amazing? Because John Wick has action set pieces like nobody's business. And it's so, so fun, but it's not actually funny. It's all super violent. The reason The Nice Guys is so great is because Shane Black wrote that incredible crackling dialogue and Ryan Reynolds handled it so well, and he's so charismatic, and I think that movie would be just as good if it wasn't Russell Crowe. It could have been anybody opposite Gosling. So let's have it be Keanu Reeves. And the Continental Hotel is one of the most interesting locations we have had in recent memory in a film. I want to know what the concierge of that place has to do. And I think that that is a movie that would be funny, smart, filled with great fight sequences, and I would love to watch.
All right, Koi, you're up.
I want to see a Spider-Man Deadpool film more than most anything in my life. In the comics, Deadpool is obsessed with Spider-Man, and Spider-Man begrudgingly deals with Deadpool. Now, in the MCU, they've done this thing where Spider-Man is much younger. Now, if they keep a young, if in this magical world where they cross over, if they keep young Spider-Man, because I enjoy Tom Holland Spider-Man very much, I realize that'd be a very tricky thing with an R-rated Deadpool. So my idea was that Deadpool kidnaps Spider-Man, and the road trip comedy is because with no power comes no responsibility. So a kidnapped Spider-Man goes along with Deadpool on a road trip to Tijuana, where his age doesn't matter. And we get into hijinks with criminals like Hammerhead and Tombstone. We can deal with like the Mexican cartel, and they can single-handedly, the two of them, through wacky road trip hijinks, deal with different villains we wouldn't see in a normal superhero movie, all while dealing with how young Spider-Man is and the R-ratedness of Deadpool. And I think that with no power comes no responsibility is a great tagline.
I like it too. Cody, what's your pick?
I picked this not knowing how much Koi would be happy about this. I want to see a Lethal Weapon 5.
Who's directing?
Who am I teaming up? Lethal Weapon 5 is teamed up with Riggs with none other than RoboCop.
Wow.
The ultimate straight man that is RoboCop. Murtaugh retires, becomes the chief of the police department, bring in this new guy, this young kid, all the way from old Detroit to help clean up the city, and he's being matched up with Riggs. And RoboCop and Riggs are dealing with, and you get dealing with the city and the straight man, crazy man dynamic that would be going on. RoboCop as statuesque as possible and every scene, and Riggs being crazy and trying to get himself killed at all times. But he has a much better time doing it because RoboCop can't get killed, so he just consistently puts RoboCop in the most dangerous scenarios possible. Also, it gives us an opportunity to hear RoboCop break out of his shell a little bit, so to speak, and say the line, "I'm too old for this chip."
Oh, so many puns. The groan in here was
the
audible.
The internet just groaned. The internet just went.
I want it. I want it. Wow. With all, and I'd see all three of these movies. But that's what I want to see.
I want to see this one first.
I would see RoboCop. I would see Lethal Weapon 5 with Riggs and RoboCop right now, especially way more than the show that they're doing right now.
All
right,
guys, which one? Why don't you want to see the other two? More than yours.
I feel like mine is the most topical. I feel like mine is the age of superheroes. I feel like Deadpool made all the money. Spider-Man's going to make all the money. And I feel like a road trip movie with superheroes hasn't been done yet. Though the Thor one will be cosmic, I think a smaller Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. I feel like an 80s-esque road trip comedy with Spider-Man and Deadpool. Those two sitting, the reason Deadpool worked was the silly little moments of like walk and talks. The idea of two superheroes sitting in costume in a car driving across the country taking on crime is beautiful. And then adding Tijuana, the young versus old, the R-rated, all of that makes for a perfect buddy cop film.
One thing that bothers me about that is you have two of the best, like if you take Iron Man out of the equation, you have like two of the best mouths mm-hmm. in the universe, and what you need is you need somebody, a straight man. Yeah, and you need somebody who isn't going, because then it's just funny, I'm funny, and I need somebody who is like the Captain America.
See, I was worried about that in Deadpool, but then they really made it work because they didn't have a direct non-straight man. No, they wrote it well enough.
I'm not saying I don't want to see Deadpool and Spider-Man together. I am worried that it'll just be on constant quips and absolutely nothing to keep it together. I'm also worried about the violence. What Spider-Man's going to be dealing with this destructive violence that is...
Well, beginning, he's not able to be. That's the no power. He's been literally kidnapped. My only concern, and believe me, I would pay whatever money I have to make Lethal Weapon 5 happen, is Murtaugh has a little bit of flex, so the straight man isn't as straight. With RoboCop, that would go against his programming, so as much of the problem mine has with two of this, that might be too much.
RoboCop's programming gets reprogrammed. If you not remember RoboCop 1, Directive 4 was then changed. He was able to kill the head of OCP at the end of the movie. So, you know...
But even if you change his programming, he's still a robot. And the thing that makes the dynamic of Lethal Weapon so interesting is that we get to have the Greek chorus of Danny Glover, and we get to sort of feel what he's feeling. And I don't think people can empathize truly with RoboCop. And as much as I appreciate both of these concepts, and I think that the truth is we probably will see a version of yours at some point, because as Marvel and DC roll out more and more and more, they're going to keep pairing people up. To take The Nice Guys and John Wick, which were such unexpected, great films, and to take characters that in truth are, in their own ways, incredibly iconic, and put them in a place that I think desperately needs to be investigated to more depth, that is where we need to go in film. I think that that is a movie that audiences, the same way with Deadpool, could vote with their dollars and be like, yes, this is the kind of stuff we want to see more of.
I feel like Ryan Gosling did an amazing job opposite Russell Crowe, and their chemistry made that very special. I'm not sure, and I know you mentioned Russell Crowe being not as important, but I feel like Russell Crowe's levity in darkness allowed for his character to really flourish, whereas John Wick was a much better lone wolf. His character was literally a lone wolf because he was hunting for his dog that was killed. I'm not sure John Wick with someone would do as well as John Wick alone.
Not to mention Ryan Gosling would get killed because... in John Wick, the only guy that he had, the two guys that he had trusting in the movie, both got themselves killed. You had Willem Dafoe got killed for helping him out, and then you had the other what was the guy in the hotel room who helped Kenneth? He got killed. So basically, Ryan Gosling would die within 5 minutes of this movie.
No, because in this movie, they're taking over the job of Lance Reddick. They're now the concierge. So it's less about them fighting each other and more about people who come to the hotel, the checkings in and out, what goes on in that bar downstairs, what's happening all around, and they're sort of trying to cater to these crazy people, and then they get wrapped up in a mystery, but they are forced to team up because they're given the assignment of having to work together. And as much as I appreciate that John Wick was a lone wolf, he didn't want to be. He wanted to be connected.
That's why when Daisy died.
But then you're saying that the fact that he has a new dog in the new movie isn't interesting. The fact that he wanted it, like he has such a big heart. That was the loss. That was what drove him.
I feel like
Gosling
would have more to do
heart.
Than a dog, though. Like a Gosling versus dog scenario. Like him, he's still a lone wolf with a dog. It's not like the dog's gonna do as much as Ryan Gosling.
Right. Lone wolf, dog, Gosling, and that, again.
Is that your new pack?
Dude, that's a pack I would roll hard with.
Cody, last thoughts why the other two aren't as good as yours.
Well, I haven't seen The Nice Guys, so I really can't make a massive torpedo argument to this. As for yours, I would totally see it. I mean, hell, I'd see yours. I've never even seen The Nice Guys yet. I love Shane Black. I would totally see yours, but I honestly would rather see what they're doing next, and that's bringing in Cable, because it would be, you know, they could play off each other a lot better, I feel.
And he's very close to RoboCop. I see your
he
love
is.
There.
And basically, it's the movie that I already said, so I want to see it.
Sasha, why are the other two not as good?
I think that mine has a better universe to go into. I know we've got like the MCU, but I'm saying the Continental Hotel as a place, as a location, is something that would be so fascinating. These are characters that don't have a lot of existing IP, so we can go anywhere we want with them. There isn't a set of constraints already wrapped up in it. We can take it as far as we possibly can go, and I think that this is truly the next generation of superheroes and action stars, and that's what both of these guys are doing. They're trying to resurrect something and make something better with people we already know, but let's just take it to the next level and let's go next gen already.
Go ahead, last thoughts?
I feel like Lethal Weapon 5 would already be a very unique thing with these aged actors. I feel like adding RoboCop to that would throw it, because RoboCop, they tried recently and it didn't work out, and the market for it is not right, and I feel like RoboCop's a dated enough property that they might actually mess up Lethal Weapon. And then I feel like with...
Lethal Weapon 4 did that.
Yeah, I'm moving on. I'm retconning it in my mind. And then I feel like with John Wick, his character for me was so interesting because he was able to do what buddy duos do by himself. Every time John Wick was on screen, he was taking out he was in a melee taking out all these people. I feel like that's more interesting than him with anyone. As much as I love the nice guys, I feel like they worked together, he worked separate. I wouldn't want to see them together.
You need comedy.
Dan, anything yes. to add over there?
I mean, nothing really, except I think, Sasha, you might have accidentally slipped Ryan Reynolds into the nice guys.
she did. I didn't want to.
Twitter tells me that you accidentally slipped Ryan Reynolds into the nice guys.
Listen, at least
you
put Scott Eastwood in there.
That's true.
Scott Eastwood.
All right. Based on these pitches.
I have a poll, too, by the
way. I think it came down. Well, Sasha gets the point. Here's why. I just think it sounded the most interesting, and I think there, as you said, there was some. Your criticisms, I think she still made them fun. Coy did sort of knock you out, so almost had you there, because I just think. I don't know if RoboCop's going to hold up to that. And then Spider-Man Deadpool, you sort of knocked each other out because he's right. I think Cable's the right next thing, and we go there. So. Sasha, I thought, and I didn't see hear enough about why that was not as good as the other two. You did get
just,
a little bit, but
just didn't see the good guys.
It sounded fun, and you didn't see it, so it didn't help you. So yeah, so Sasha got the final point that put Sasha and Coy in the finals.
Oh, scary!
Cody, round of applause.
See ya.
Close again, but you're gonna come back, right?
No.
But you're super funny.
Oh, he'll come back. He's got nothing else to do.
For the record,
I am unemployed right now. Thanks, Rockies.
Oh, you will. You will. And now it's your turn to help me, okay? So you get to help decide which one of these two.
Let's do it.
Gets at the end. Zach over there, Dan, you guys are going to help as well. So all three of you guys, listen to the arguments, please, as we move into speed round.
For the record, Spider-Man and Deadpool won the...
Hands down.
...online poll. I don't think you want to know by how much.
98%.
Like, of course. That sounds good.
It had 74% of the vote.
Sounds good.
Thanks, Internet.
Coy already won, so there you go. Doesn't matter. I mean, he's already in this.
Yep.
What was the second place?
They were both like at 13%.
Didn't matter.
Each, yeah.
See, both your pitches sucked, is what the internet's telling you.
No way, man. I want to see that movie.
I want to see all three of them.
Constant air service.
All right, you guys know how speed round works. You'll have 20 seconds, each of you. I'm going to throw a question out. Whoever says the answer first gets to have that answer. If you both say the same thing, it's whoever said it first. You'll have to pick something else. You'll each get 20 seconds. Whoever says out loud first will go first. And then you'll each get 10-second rebuttal time. Any questions before we begin? So again, you're going quick. First one's going to be a visual aid on the screen, so you're going to want to look up there. It's our bargain bin picture. This was submitted by Not Going to Help on Twitter, and they found these two movies in the bargain bin. Which one should we buy?
Star Trek Into Darkness.
Great, I'll take
Amazing Spider-Man 2.
That's the Amazing Spider-Man 2?
That is 2. There's Electro.
Wow. Oh, God. Oh, shit. Okay.
All right, so Coy got Into Darkness, and Sasha got Spider-Man 2. All right. Coy, since you went first, you'll start. Time starts when you start speaking.
Sorry, hang on.
Hold on, Danny.
I'm falling down on the job over here.
No, you're doing a great job.
Okay, I'm ready.
Whenever you're ready,
yep.
Coy.
Star Trek Into Darkness did an amazing thing where it opened as if you were presented with a world of the Star Trek TV shows. It inserted you into this new planet, it allowed time to pass between the first film, and it continued the story of the first film well, whereas Amazing Spider-Man had a character that didn't act like Spider-Man. He was mean, he was malicious, and it just disrespected the source material to such a level that it shouldn't exist. Andrew Garfield is Spider-Man. How do you mess that up?
Andrew Garfield will no longer be Spider-Man, so don't you want to have a good send-off? Don't you want to see him one more time in that character? You also get Jamie Foxx with that crazy, huge insane action set piece. As much as Star Trek wanted to be good, that one was made for a foreign audience and it wasn't actually made for Americans. At least Amazing Spider-Man 2 wanted to speak to the audience that already knew and loved the source material. And Star Trek Into Darkness just was like, oh, big action.
Amazing Spider-Man 2 did a thing where it not only disrespected itself, it hurt comics. It made the comics feel false and it ruined the franchise. It has restarted Sony. It ruined Sony to the level they had to sell them to Marvel. That is a failure.
That's a complete overstatement. That was complete hyperbole. And Star Trek is restarting itself now because they realized Into Darkness was such a mess that they were like, we gotta fix this with Beyond. We gotta win our fans back. So to say that it ruined everything...
Ooh, the last two, the last you both, because he knocked you, and then you did get him right back there. But so, yeah. Ooh, Zach, what did you think based on those arguments?
I like Spider-Man. I don't know what to say.
You like Spider-Man?
I really don't.
I like that answer.
Cody,
you were dealt a really rough hand. but
he's pointing at Sasha.
But yeah, you're dealt a real rough one on this. But you did totally have me when you mentioned that Andrew Garfield was not a bad Spider-Man. I completely disagreed with you on him being a bad Spider-Man.
No, I said he was a good Spider-Man.
But you said he was kind of cruel. What was it?
I said he was mean-spirited.
I didn't find him to be mean-spirited. I just thought the movie was just terrible. But you said, did you say you wanted to bring Jamie Foxx back?
No, he was in it.
He had a great set piece.
I said that he was good and they ruined a good Andrew Garfield.
And I said you need to send Garfield
off. This is a real Sophie's Choice of shit. I mean, flip a coin.
Very unclear. I'm gonna make the call. You both tied down the last. I thought on the follow ups, but in the first round, I did think Coy got a little bit more in. Why? That was what put me over the edge. It was very close, but I think you were reaching.
That was a hard
one. Yeah. We got a little bit more straight.
That just broke my heart more.
So that's why I got the first point.
Oy, all right.
Sorry, I was no help on that.
That was hard.
He really delayed the show.
Defending how do I begin to do
it's
this
your show?
To...
All right, number two. No, everyone's doing great. Here we go. Number two. Better X-Men ensemble, classic or post-First Class?
Post-First Class.
So you're going for the original X-Men, X2, Last Stand, and you're going First Class, Days of Future Past, and Apocalypse.
Okay, the reason...
So hold on, sorry. Coy is doing First Class, I'm sorry, Classic, and Sasha's doing First Class. Go ahead, Sasha.
Okay, because not only do you get this incredible new cast where you have, I mean, Nightcrawler is so great this time around. You have such a great, oh my God, I'm blanking on his name. Okay, but you also get Patrick Stewart, you also get Ian McKellen, you also get the people that you love the most because nobody needs to see Halle Berry come back and do fucking Storm again. Nobody needs that. And nothing's better than Michael Fassbender. Michael Fassbender and James Back.
All the names you listed are in the original films until Michael Fassbender. So I feel like the first films kind of just proved my point. And I think that in the original, they actually invested a little bit more in the characters. Nightcrawler in X2 was much better than this version it looks like we're getting now. And I think that we learned who Wolverine was more than we learned who anyone was in First Class. And we followed the characters in a smaller contained setting, so we were more invested. And they had more time because there were less. They weren't just throwing spaghetti at the wall. They were actually looking at...
That's absolutely not true. The reason we know Wolverine is because of the standalone movies. But when you look at these films, what I was saying is Fassbender and McAvoy are so incredible. Jennifer Lawrence has taken Mystique to a whole new level, and the thing that is great is that you get the things that you liked before.
Wolverine movies were not things where you learned anything about Wolverine. They were, in fact, distracted. The Wolverine movies are so bad they had to use one of your movies to fix the original trilogy to make it back in continuity. The original movies...
The head explode moment. Make sure you replay that.
Wow.
That was really funny. I hate to ask. I think this was pretty clear, idea. But Cody...
The reason why is because you used characters from the original trilogy.
Yeah,
that
didn't help you at all.
I just kind of felt like you made his argument for him before he even opened his mouth.
Greg, the worst.
Wolverine, man, that is like.
I think we're all leaning towards Coy winning that argument. Do you disagree, Greg? Dan, you guys on the same page? Okay. So Coy's up. That means she's got to get the
it's
next.
It's a must-win situation.
Yeah, right.
It's a must-win.
Okay. Here we go. This is a creative one. No, we're talking the movies. Actually, I'm going to change the order.
Oh, poop.
Change the order. Just make this
keep in mind, Sasha, your back is against the wall here.
I know.
You gotta write the table.
Well aware. Thanks, Merle.
No pressure in the speed
round. Yeah. Speed round's the worst.
Cody, which one's more fun? This one, right?
Yeah, I like that one.
Ready? I'm gonna name two actresses. You gotta tell me who's better.
And tell me why. Great.
Amy Adams or Jennifer Lawrence?
Amy Adams.
Ooh, Sasha got it.
You got it.
All right, so Sasha's up first with Amy Adams. And go when you're ready.
Amy Adams actually transitions into characters. If you look at who she played in Junebug as opposed to who she plays in BVS, she's entirely different. Jennifer Lawrence plays herself over and over, and as charming and effusive as that can be, it's just the same thing. Amy Adams is a true actress. She's a chameleon. Her career has had so many different levels. Winter's Boner was one thing, and now Jennifer Lawrence just plays the same person.
Jennifer Lawrence in regular public life has these wacky hijinks. In her roles, she is usually much more subdued, much more contained, like in Winter's Bone, and in Joy, and she puts Oscar-worthy performances into things she doesn't necessarily have to. She, like you said in the last round, Mystique, she actually made that character that's so many multifaceted and layered that you're more invested in someone that can shapeshift. Jennifer Lawrence has the chops to play both blue people and indies like Winter's Bone.
Amy Adams makes bad movies better. She is one of the best parts in Man of Steel. Jennifer Lawrence plays the same character. Joy was garbage. Winter's Bone is not as good of a movie if you rewatch it. She is a little one level.
American Hustle existed in part because Jennifer Lawrence made that character shine, and she does that with most of her films. So I'd argue that she is a bigger draw and a better actress than Amy Adams because she makes these small films or these large films totally work in every way.
Jennifer.
Ooh, that was a good one. Greg, I'm coming to you. I hope you were listening based on the arguments.
Zach. Yes. Oh, my name is Zach.
That's why he's laughing. I like that. Zach, I'm the worst.
I'd have to go with Jennifer Lawrence on that one.
Cody.
Honestly, I got to go with the argument for Amy Adams.
Yay! Thanks, dude.
Yeah, I was leaning Amy Adams not to throw Greg under the bus.
Is that Scott Eastwood?
I don't know where that even. Maybe it was on my Twitter thing. I'm sorry, Zach. You're Zach. Sorry, Zach. I am also going against you. I thought I heard a little bit more strength on the Amy Adams acting chops, and J-Law plays the same.
Since we both said Amy Adams, I was like, oh no. And I personally
Sasha's still in. All right.
May I ask a question to Sasha? Was Winter's Boner intentional?
Yes.
Okay.
That's what my friend calls it.
Good to know.
It was good.
Yeah.
Winter's Boner. It's not that good if you rewatch it.
Here we go.
A squirrel.
If you could have any X-Men movie character's power, which would you want?
Jean Grey.
Sasha?
Wolverine.
Okay, we got Jean Grey versus Wolverine. Now we're talking powers. Movie powers. All right, Koi, you're up first.
Not only does Jean Grey powers allow her to fly and think and perceive the world, she would literally be all-knowing, and there's nothing more powerful than infinite knowledge. Whereas Wolverine, his power is healing, which means he'd live forever, so his life would be full of remorse, sadness, and seeing all of his friends die, while Jean Grey would get to exist in a world where she knew everything and could perceive the world in a way that none of us will ever have, and she can fly because of her telekinesis. That's incredible. She can move things with the mind. She would never have to...
She's miserable, too, and the thing with Wolverine is I'm a woman in Hollywood. I would love to never age, and then I could keep working. And with Wolverine, you can take on anything, and you've got claws that can... be your fucking, I don't know. I'm like, that was a great argument. Just give it to him.
Oh, wow.
That was great.
You had it.
I thought you were doing great with the Jean's miserable portion. I'm like, that was the torpedo.
She is miserable, but that was a great argument.
Wow. She bowed out gracefully. You did it. You got the point. Oh. You win the game.
Thank you, guys. Man.
Good job, man.
I was going to come back when Wolverine feels all the pain of his healing. And I had this whole counter argument. I was like, okay, what am I
doing? That was great. I mean, and the Jean Grey argument was great.
Good job. That was nice a good round. Good fight all around, guys.
Nice.
Nice, clean fight. They brought it for you guys. Let's thank them again. Nice work, all three of you.
Okay.
Cody Decker at Decker6 on Twitter. Anything else you'd like to plug?
No. If any major league teams are watching this, I hit a lot of home runs. I'm available right now. I'm at home.
Please, come on, major league.
Oh, and look at my YouTube channel, Anti-Hero Baseball. See my latest film, which has Hal Rudnick from Screen Junkies in it, of course. So please check it out.
I'll have to tweet that out. Sasha Pearl Raver at Sasha Pearl Raver. Congrats.
Thanks, man. So close. Well, you guys can see me on Mondays with Mr. Fact Checker over there, Dan Merle, and I will be back on June 7th. To hopefully win TV fights
TV
more
fights,
valiantly than this.
You versus Hal and Matt
God.
Lieberman
Murders
for the TV
Row.
Fight belt. Dan and I weren't in the running.
Nope.
But whoever wins,
Thank
I think
God.
You and me, Dan, will have to take a round on with him and see what happens.
We'll see what happens.
Koi, Jan, how do I?
Jondro.
Jondro, there we go. Thank you. I'm the worst with names.
It's
people make fun of me. I called him Greg for like four rounds.
It's way easier to say than it looks, to be fair.
McCoy, anything you'd like to plug?
I host Marvel Movie News every week. We just moved from Thursdays to Tuesdays. It's a live show at 11. We have a live chat that's amazing. It's a great corner of the internet. I love Marvel. I love DC. And I think that that this amazing superhero times is awesome. So all the geeks that watch this and every comic fan of the world, go buy local comics and you're great. And I just dropped an Apocalypse thing on this network today.
You guys explained Apocalypse.
We tried, man.
It's a lot of history to him.
He's a real pouchy villain. Real 90s.
Yep. Dan Merle at Merle Dan.
Coy knows more about Apocalypse than most people will ever forget. you can see my review of X-Men Apocalypse Monday on YouTube. And just a reminder, if you missed SJU yesterday, Sasha and I will be on next Tuesday morning at 11 a.m. To do Summer Movie Report, because we want to do the whole four-day Memorial Day weekend.
Great. And not Greg, it's Zach Roberts over there. Zach, anything you'd like to plug?
Fluxus Skateboard Co. It's my skateboard company. Nice. You can check it out on Instagram at Fluxus, F-L-U-X-U-S.
Hit up Zach and go hashtag Greg. And also, I'd like to make sure Andy Signor for me, but I'd like to plug that Dan, Spencer, myself, and some special guests are going to be at Wizard World Philadelphia. Not this very weekend you're watching, but the following weekend, the 3rd and the 4th of June. Excited to go back to my hometown, moderating a Captain America panel with the man himself.
Oh, that's awesome.
It's going to be so fun. I'm going to ask him that. I'm going to talk to them about that. As well as we're doing an Osh trailer panel, some exclusives, a movie fights panel. It's going to be so much fun if you're in Philly, East Coaster. Come on down and join us. That's everything. We'll be here after the fight. Thank you all for watching. Have a great weekend. Bye-bye.
Every podcast we put on YouTube comes with this kick-ass graphic listing all the topics your favorite Screen Junkies podcasters are talking about. If you click the topics, you can skip around and choose your own podcast battle royale. Go ahead, try them all. If you haven't already, subscribe to Screen Junkies on YouTube to join us for future fights. Or if you prefer to listen on iTunes, click the logo to download an audio version.